Greetings, our Hebrew Israelite brothers and sisters. This is A.L.D. Smith, the watchman on the wall. And you're a watchman, Israel. We got a fine teaching tonight. But first and foremost, we want to give a shout out to the whole family. Happy Sabbath, Israel. Now, that being said, we want to give praise to the Most High for all that He has done for us and all that He's doing. And we praise the Most High for allowing us to come into your homes, Israel, every midweek teaching and on our Sabbath. Now, that being said, let's go forward into our teaching tonight. We're going to be dealing with the mix and the mingles, the mixed multitude that came out of Egypt. And most of all, we're going to show that God is only concerned with His children, and that is the children of Israel. Okay, now we would come from the book of Genesis, the 17th chapter. We're going to read verses 5. It says, "Neither shall thy name anymore be called Abram, but thy name shall be called Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee." Now we see here that God here is already beginning to have structure here to make Himself a people. All right, now let us go to Exodus chapter 3. Okay, now because we know that the Most High is going to have Isaac, and he's going to have Jacob. Okay, and we know that the 12 tribes are going to come out of Jacob's loins. Okay, but now let us start here in Exodus chapter 3. We're going to read verses 6, and then we're going to do 14 and 15. Okay, Exodus chapter 3, verse 6. It says, "Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. All right, now let us jump over here and read verses 14 and 15. It says, "And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. He said, thus shall thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you. And God said moreover unto Moses, thus shall thou say unto the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations." So what he's saying here, this should solidify everything here, because we see here that he has an S on generation. He says that I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has sent me unto you. To who? The children of Israel. He says, this is my name forever, and this is a memorial unto all generations. See that? All generations of who? The Hebrew Israelites. Nobody else. Now, let's go a little further here. Let's go to Exodus 12. Exodus chapter 12. Let's look at that. Now, let's look at verses 35 and 36. It says here that "and the children of Israel did according to the words of Moses, and borrowed the Egyptian jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiment." So they borrowed it, but they had no intentions of bringing it back. Now look what the Most High does. He says, "And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians." See that? God softened the Egyptian heart and told him, go ahead and give it to him. See, God is in control of everything. Now look what he says, "so that they lent unto them such things as they required, and they spoiled the Egyptians." They took all this stuff, stripped them. All right, now let us go here a little further. We're going to Exodus 34. Now let's go to Exodus 34 here, and let's read this right here, 34. Let's read verses 16. Exodus 34, verse 16, it says, but let's read 14, 15, 16. It says, "For thou shalt worship no other God, for the Lord whose name is Jealous is a jealous God. Lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and go a horn after their gods, and do sacrifice unto their gods, and one call thee to eat his sacrifice, and thou take of their daughters." See that? and unto thy sons and their daughters go a horn after their gods, and make thy sons go a horn after their gods. See, God does not want his children to be mingling with any other nation than their own, because each nation have their own gods. They got their own way of living. They have their own society. But God has a structure. God has given his children laws. He have given them statutes. He's giving them structure as he's getting them ready to leave out of Egypt. He's telling them, I don't want you mingling no more. But now we already know that they have been mingling with the Egyptians down in Egypt. So God is saying, now we're on our way out. I don't want you doing that no more. Okay, now let's go here a little further. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy, the seventh chapter. Now look what it says here. Let's read all of it from 1 down to verse 4. It says, when the Lord thy God shall bring thee into the land, whether thou goest to possess it, and has cast out many nations before thee, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, and the Canaanites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than thou. And when the Lord thy God shall deliver them before thee, thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them. Thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor show mercy unto them. And see, God doesn't change. God was saying, look, when I take you into this land over here, I want you to literally destroy them. Don't have any mercy on them. And see, this is the way God is going to have us when he comes back. He's going to tell you, he's going to put this in his people to not have any mercy. That's right. And I pray that the Most High put all that in me. I want all of it. I want him to make me just the way he wants me to be. And I know he doesn't change. Now let's go here a little further here. He says, neither shall thou make marriage with them. Thy daughters thou shalt not give unto his sons, nor his daughters shall thou take unto thy son, for they will turn away thy son from following me, that they may serve other gods. So will the anger of the Lord be kindled against you and destroy thee suddenly. See that? God is still saying he does not want you to be with anyone else but your own. Nobody else. If you in the tribe of Gad, then you be with Gad. If you in the tribe of Simeon, then you be with Simeon. You in the tribe of Judah, then you stay with Judah. Don't cross up. God even said the Most High even said in the book of Leviticus, he said that don't even put two seeds out in the field at the same time. Different seeds. He said, if you're going to plant seed, plant the same seed. Don't put two out there. One this and one that. No, he said, that is how strict he is about mingling. He does not want you to mingle. Now he goes on here. Let's go to the book of Nehemiah. The book of Nehemiah. Let's go there real quick. The book of Nehemiah. Let's find it real quick here. Nehemiah. I need to go to Nehemiah real quick. And we'll get it here in a minute. Nehemiah chapter 9. Now watch this, my brother and sister. Nehemiah chapter 9. Let's look at verses 1, 2, and 3. It says, now in the 20th and 4th day of this month, the children of Israel were assembled with fasting and sackcloth and earth upon them. So they threw sand upon them. He says, and the seed of Israel separated themselves from all strangers and stood and confessed their sins, and the iniquity of their father. So here we see here, Israel is confessing their sins because of what? They have heard the word of the Most High, and they are confessing their sins about mingling with the strangers, with strange flesh. So here, I'm going to show it to you again. Now, let's read, let's read verse 3. And they stood. He said, and they stood up in the place and read in the book of the law of the Lord their God one fourth part of the day and another fourth part. They confess and worship the Lord their God. See, so when that word came forth, it pricked them on the inside. And they realized, oh, what we've been doing. We have been mingling the holy seed. We have been taking wives with all the strange flesh. And they came and repented. So, but now, if you go back and start reading from Nehemiah to the first chapter and then read on down, you'll see how they got back into that mingling. And then the word of God came, pricked them, and they confessed their sins. And got away from the strange women and the strange husbands. Now let's look at Nehemiah chapter 10. Let's look at that one. Nehemiah chapter 10, I believe. Let me see if that's right. No, let's look at 13. Let's look at 13 here. Nehemiah 13:3. All right. It said, now it came to pass when they had heard the law. Talking about the law of Moses. That God had gave Moses, that they separated from all Israel, from Israel, all the mixed multitude. See that? They had gotten back into the same old bullshit, marrying and mingling up, and then when the word came, they said, oh, no, we done messed up. We got to repent. Now, my question, why would God go through all this right now, you know, and then say, okay, today, you know, we can go ahead and do that? No, because he's coming back for Israel. And see, like, if you got anything in you besides Israel, you ain't none of his. I mean, we're being fair here. I mean, I'm being straight up with you. If you are mixed with anything else, you are not the original. That's common sense. And you can look around you, and you can see all these other nations that are around you. And you allow the Caucasians to tell you, but y'all all the same. But yet and still, you can look at the queen over there in England, and she looks just like any other old little white lady that's over here in America. But yet and still, they all know. The queen knows that she is not an American, and the American knows that the queen is not American. And they look just alike. They look just alike. But you understand, you can go out your door, and you can see all these other people, all these other things that's walking around, and you allow somebody to tell you that y'all are the same and y'all look nothing alike. I mean, nothing. Nothing. And then, you guys, you know, they strut around like a peacock with one that got freckles in the face and looking like they are daughters of the Kennedy families or somebody like Beyonce, you know, and you strutting around walking around like you got something and you don't know what you have. You got a mango. And don't even realize it. You think, well, you got something, and I'm telling you, that couldn't be further from the truth. Because look, let me take you back to the garden. When God created the first man out of dust of the earth, the word of the Most High says, he breathed the breath of life in man, and man became a living soul. So all those that came after Adam, on up into Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, and on down to all of us who are true Hebrew Israelites, we got a soul. But the rest of them don't. They don't have a soul because God just created them. And just because they walk and talk, that is a universal look. You got a head, you got arms, you got torso, you got legs, you got feet, you got toes, you got a mouth, you got tongue, teeth, or eyes, or Look, that is a universal look. But that doesn't make you Hebrew. That doesn't make you a child of the Most High. Only if you have his DNA. You must have his DNA. If you don't have his DNA, you're none of his. And I know it may sound, you know, kind of tragic, you know, to those, but for instance, like if I go outside and I mate with a woman that is real, real light skin, like she can be one or two shades from being, you know, a full Caucasian. We have kids, I just committed suicide. If I stay with that, I just committed suicide because I can't produce anything that has life with her. Nothing. But now if I stay with my a black queen, who is a Hebrew, we have children, that child has a soul and it has life in it. But when you go outside, all you're committing is strange flesh, because God doesn't even have a name for it. He calls it strange flesh. That don't even have a name for it. But everybody want to holler, I'm black, I'm black, I'm black. How? I mean, well, it's many shades of black. Well, then why is it not many shades of white? That's my question. You let the white man, you tell you all kind of bullshit. All kind of, I mean, like I said, the queen over in England, she knows that she is English. She's an Englishman. And Caucasians over here, they know they're white. And they look just alike. But you ask them, they tell you, oh no, we're different. We're nothing alike. And they look alike. And you let somebody tell you that we, all of us over here are y'all just alike. And you can look and see, no, we don't have anything in common. And like the hell about black on black crime, you know what I mean? No, that's nation on nation. See, because mama done had a baby by this man who was a mingle. Mama done had a baby by this man who was a mingle. And then you got all those nations. And then those nations grow up and then go out and then they have babies, children with other mingles, and then now they have created something else. And it is a vicious cycle that is perpetuated over and over and over. And then you get all these 51,000 nations and everybody hollering about I'm black. I mean, it is sad. It's sad, but it's true. And everybody want to holler about it. Like I say, you know, all those that's on the internet, you know, they looking like, you know, more that's like the white man child. And I got a beard and look like the white man child, and that can be further from the truth. You're not a Hebrew. Not looking like him. You're a master's child. You are not a child of the Most High. I mean, you don't fit any of the criteria that the scripture says. None. But you try to claim it, you know, you say it, well, maybe if I dress like it, or maybe if I try to act like it, or well, maybe if I could speak the shittish language, you know what I mean, Yiddish or whatever shittish. Well, listen, you're not speaking Hebrew either. You're not. None of those acts makes you a Hebrew. The only way that you're a Hebrew is that you have to be born. I mean, if you just look at the things around you, it would tell you. The Morris Show tells them all the time, you are not the father. You are the father. I mean, it's right all around you, but you understand people overlook that. And then, I mean, you can take a three-year-old and give them a crayon box and then tell them to pick their colors out. I guarantee you, they will pick out all of them colors that you tell them to pick out. And there is not all those colors in that box. Or shades of black. I mean, that's how stupid people of color sound. I mean, how could you allow somebody to tell you such foolish ass shit? And you grab hold to it and just walk around. Well, we all. No, we're not all. We're not. It has to be DNA. That's the only way, the bloodline. The bloodline has to be pure. The bloodline is tainted, you ain't none of his. You ain't none of his. You can go out here and sleep with a woman who is a mingle and then have kids with them. They're not Hebrew. You can think about it all you want to. You can't change it. You can go out here and be a Hebrew woman and lay around with a man that look like Terrence Williams, Terrence whatever his name is, play on Empire. You have children. They're not Hebrew. You may want them to be, but they're not because the bloodline has been tainted. Now let's go a little further here. Let us leave Nehemiah and let's go back to Deuteronomy 29:29. See, because if you see it here, you will understand why they don't get it. And they get angry. They get angry and then make all kind of derogatory comments, you know, on the page, you know, about me and about you guys. You know, y'all shouldn't listen to him and this and that. But, I mean, it's right in the pages. And the reason why they don't get it is because they're not Hebrew. Now, they can get along with all the rest of them out there. All the rest of them out there. They get along because they all saying the same bullshit. But over here, we're saying something totally different. And they see what we're saying because last week, guy came on and was talking all kind of old crazy ass shit. And I told him straight up and down, I said, look, you're not Hebrew. You're not Hebrew. That's why you don't get it. His reply was, I get your message. Yeah, you got some good points. But I don't get you. Now, how can you disagree with the one that gave the message, but yet and still accept the message? That to me doesn't make any sense at all. And he never replied and said that he wasn't a mingle. So I know they don't get it. They do not get it. But anyway, let's look at Deuteronomy 29:29. It said, the secret things belongeth unto the Lord, but those things which are revealed belongeth unto us and our children forever. Not part way down, but forever. He said that we might do all the words of the law. Now we see here that it explicitly says that who? It's for us and our children throughout all the generations. Keep on going 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years. It's only for us. But others try to understand it, but they can't. And they get frustrated and they say, oh, well, he don't know what he's talking about and this and that. Just because you've been reading it for longer than I have, or you think you have, that still doesn't mean that the Most High is talking to you. And for a fact, I know that he's not talking to strange flesh. He's not. I just read to you. It is revealed for the children. To the children. Nobody else. Now, let's move on. For sake of time, let's look at their book, John 3:16. John 3:16. Now let's go and look at that. John 3:16. Now this is one of the favorite scriptures that the Christians hold on to. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, if you guys go back in the Old Testament, God speaks for himself. God does not have somebody else speak for him. When God is speaking in the Old Testament, you know it's him because he identifies himself. But here, you got to say, John is saying that for God so loved the world. God never said that. The Most High never said that at any time. He said that the whole world is his. Yes. And he said everything that was created by him. Yes. But he never said that he loved the whole world. He never said that at any time. But the Christians, they'll listen to what John said instead of trying to listen to what God said. Or Jesus saying. This is John writing here talking about what Jesus said because it's in red. But Jesus is saying for God. God never said that he loved the world and loved everybody in the world at any time. He said he loved Israel. He said, Jacob I love, Esau I hated. He said that. And he said that he hated other, he hated all those other nations. But he never said at any time that he loved all those nations. How could he say he loved all those nations and he went out and destroyed all those other nations? All of them. That doesn't make any sense to me at all. But anyway, let's keep on going. Let's go to Peter. Let's go to Peter over here. First Peter. Because the Christian, they have a false hope. I'm going to show them him. First Peter. Let's look at chapter 2. Let's look at verses 9. 2 and 9. Look what it says. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praise of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now, my brothers and sisters, what he is saying here to all the Christians are that they are of a royal priesthood. The only priest that was royal in the Old Testament was Levi. The only one that could hold this title here was Aaron and his sons. That's it. Now, how can you come over here and then tell all the Christians now that, oh, you are of a royal priesthood? And that couldn't be further from the truth. If that being the case, then what happened to all the other tribes? What happened to Judah, Simeon, Naphtali, Gad, Dan? What happened to all these other tribes? All he's talking about here, you have a royal priesthood, so everybody that comes to Christianity is now of the tribe of Levi. Well, that's what it's saying. Because Levi is the only chosen royal priesthood. Nobody else. But anyway, we'll go forward. I just thought I might bring that out. Let's go to the book of Galatians. Let's go there to the book of Galatians here. Galatians, the third chapter. Let's look at verse 26 here. It says, for ye are all children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now, my brothers and sisters, like I said before, the only way that you can be a part of this family is you have to be born in it. It has to be DNA. If you just look around and see, even like I said on the Morris Show, you know what I mean? You are the father or you're not the father. DNA match, you are the father. DNA don't match, you are not the father. And God is saying that he's coming back for only his children. Nobody else. Nobody. Now, let's go here a little further. Let's look at John. Let's go to St. John again here. Let's go to their book, St. John, the first chapter. Let's look at that one. St. John, the first chapter. Let's look at verses 11 and 12. It says, he came to his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Now, this question that I don't understand at all. I do not understand this at all. You know what I mean? This don't make no sense, period. Now, he says, here, as many of them as received him, he gave them power, okay, to become sons of God. Okay, so we received you as God's son. So now, we are God's sons now, because we believe that you are the son of God. Then now, you come on down, next three or four words is that, even to those that believe on him. So if we believe that your name is Jesus Christ, then we become sons of God. How does that work? You know, because he said that if you confess his name and believe that God has raised him from the dead, that thou shalt be saved. I mean, all these different ways that he got for you to come, but God has one way. And that is, you have to be birthed, huh, by two Hebrews in order to be in God's family. Other than that, you're not in his family. But Jesus got all the other ways that he's telling you that you can become a part of God's family. And all those ways are nothing more than a fabrication. Now, let's go here a little further here. Let's go to 2 Samuel. And watch it right here, my brothers and sisters. Let's go to 2 Samuel. And let's see what it says. The Second Samuel, what I want to look at? Second Samuel 7. Let's look at that. Second Samuel chapter 7. Now, let's look at this right here. Second Samuel chapter 7. Let's look at verse 20, 23 and 24. Let's look at that. It says here, well, let's read 22 too. It says, wherefore thou art great, O Lord God, for there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee, according to all that we have heard with our ears. And what one nation in the earth is like thy people? Now, we had a comment the other day where some individual sent a comment saying that, well, see here, it says here that Israel is a nation. That's not what it's saying. It says that what nation is like thy people Israel. He never said any time God the Most High never called Israel at any time the nation of Israel. Not one time. Not one time. And here he's not calling them a nation. He's saying what nation of people out there that is like you. Not that you are a nation. No. There are 12 nations. Because each tribe is a nation. But he's saying what people, what nation of people is like you? None. Not none. Now look what he says here. Even like Israel, whom God went to redeem for a people to himself, and to make him a name, and to do for you great things and terrible. For thy land before thy people, which thou redeemest to thee from Egypt, from the nations of their gods. For thou hast confirmed to thyself thy people Israel, see that? To be a people unto thee forever. End of story. Now my question right here is this right now. He says Israel is going to be his forever. He never mentioned anybody else. Nobody else. But you got all of these other ones, you know, saying, well, we are Hebrew. I mean, and they don't fit any of the criteria that the Old Testament speaks about the Hebrew Israelites, what color they are, or none of that. They look more and more like the white man every day. But yes, I'm Hebrew. I'm Hebrew. Like I said in another video, Raven Simone, the woman that played That's So Raven, she told them that she was white. And they jumped all over that. She ain't white. But now we've been saying that we are the true people of the Most High, and nobody won't even touch it. Nobody won't even touch it. But they know that some of us are. And they know that some of us not. That's why they give the ones that look more like them those desk jobs to perpetuate bullshit back into our community to try to keep us blind. But the word of the Most High is the only word that we go by. We don't go by what they say on television or what the news say, or not only them, what nobody else say. We get our information strictly from the Most High. I've just King James. That's where he talks to me in the real bit. He'll come to us and tell us something, then we'll go in and look, and boom, there it is. Right in the pages. Now let's move forward here. Look what he says here. And let's go to the book of Ephesians. Let's go to the book of Ephesians real quick. Ephesians, the second chapter. Now look what it says here. Let's look at verses 4 through 6. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy, and for his great love wherewith he loved us. That's not true. Even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved. And hath raised us up together and made us to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now my question is this: what Christian do you know that is sitting in heavenly places. And then not only that, I want to know, how does the heavenly place look? Since he say that y'all sit in heavenly places, let me know what Christian is now sitting in heavenly places. That's what I want to know. But it's nothing but a fabrication. If you guys just think about what he's saying here, I mean, but you can't get it because your eyes have been shut. You can't get it. Your eyes have been shut. But anyway, let's go here a little further. I'm going to show you something here in 1 Kings. Let's go to 1 Kings. Now watch this right here. 1 Kings chapter 8. 1 Kings chapter 8. Let's look at verse 53 here. Let's look at verse 53. Look what it says here. It says, "For thou didst separate," see that? "Them from among all the people of the earth." See that? "To be thine inheritance, as thou spoke by the hand, spaketh by the hand of Moses, thy servant, when thou broughtest our fathers out of Egypt, O Lord God." See that? God's talking about separation. Separation. He's talking about separation. God is talking about separation. He wants Israel to be separated from all the rest of them. Now let's move a little further here. Let's go over here to 1 Kings chapter 10. Look at verse 9. It said, "Blessed be the Lord, thy God, which delighteth in thee, to set thee on thrones, O Israel, because the Lord loveth Israel forever." End of story. See that? He said he loveth Israel forever. Forever. "Therefore made he king to do judgment and justice." See that? The Most High says, I don't care what nobody say, I love Israel forever. Now let's go a little further here. Let's go to Chronicles. And watch this right here. Let's go to Chronicles. Now watch this. We're gonna go to 1 Chronicles. Watch this. 1 Chronicles 17. Now watch this, my brothers and sisters. 1 Chronicles 17. Let's look at verses 19, 20, and 21. Okay. "O Lord, for thy servant's sake, and according to thine own heart, hast thou done all this greatness, and making known all these great things. O Lord, there is none like thee, neither is there any God beside thee, according to all that we have heard with our ears. And what one nation in the earth is like thy people Israel?" He says again, what nation of people is like Israel? Not calling Israel the nation of Israel. No, he never said that. He says here, he said, "Who God went to redeem, to be in his own, to be his own people, to make thee a name great, name of greatness and terribleness, by driving out nations from before thy people, whom thou hast redeemed out of Egypt." See that? See that? That's the Most High. He said, ain't nobody like Israel. Nobody. That's why we always get all these derogatory comments. Why? Because we're not like the rest of them. If we were like the rest of them, Israel, you wouldn't hear nothing. You wouldn't hear nothing. But they try to come on here and downplay you and try to downplay me like they got so much knowledge and this and that. And the Most High is not even talking to them at all. They're just saying scripture and making it what they were thinking that it's saying. And the Most High, he's not talking to them. Now let's go a little further here. Let's leave Chronicles and let's go to Psalms 105. Now watch that, my brothers and sisters. Let's go to Psalms 105 here. 105. Well, let's look at another one here. Let's look at 135. 135. Let's look at 135. Then we go to 105. 135. Let's look at verse 4. 135, verse 4. It says, "For the Lord has chosen Jacob unto himself, and Israel for his peculiar treasure." See that? See that? "For I know that the Lord is great, and that our Lord is above all gods." See that? See that? God says that he has chosen Jacob unto himself in Israel for a peculiar treasure. He didn't say nobody else. He's still talking about Israel. Now, let's go to Psalms 105. This is Psalm 105, didn't it? Yeah, let's go to Psalms 105. Psalms 105, what verse am I on? Let's look at verse 8. Let's read verse 8 to 15. Look what it says. "He has remembered his covenant forever, the words which he commanded to a thousand generations, which covenant he made with Abraham and his oath with Isaac, and confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law, and to Israel for an everlasting covenant." See that? Goes right back, starts with Abraham and comes right on down to who? Jacob, and down to us as an everlasting covenant. He had ample time to add somebody else in there. No, he had time to add the mixing and mingling there. No, he only said Israel. Now, let's go a little further here. He says, "Saying unto thee, I will give the land of Canaan and the lots of your inheritance, where when they were but a few men in number, yea, very few, and strangers in it." He said, when they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to other people, he suffered no man to do them wrong. Yea, he reproved kings for their sake. See, God wouldn't change their mind. God made them not give Israel any trouble. See that? God is always in control. That's why when somebody is agitating you and fucking with you, God is causing that. When one likes you and treating you nice and stuff, God is causing that. He's in control at all times. He says, I will cause your enemies to be at peace with you. Then he says, I will cause your enemies to rise up against you. God is causing all of this. All within control. Don't nothing just rambling, that just happened. No, that was strategically done by the Most High. Now, let's go here a little further. We have 105, Psalm 105. Let's read verses 15, saying, "Touch not my anointed, and do my prophet no harm." See that? God will cause a person to be at peace with you. Oh yeah, he's always in control. Now, let us go here to let's go to Isaiah 41. Let's go there. Isaiah 41. And look at that verse. Isaiah 41. Isaiah 41. Let's look at verses 8. Look what it says. Isaiah 41, 8, it says, "But thou, Israel, art my servant, Jacob whom I have chosen." He says, "The seed of Abraham, my friend." See that? The seed of Abraham, my friend. My friend. See that? He's still talking about who? Israel. He ain't talking about nobody else. He ain't talking about the mixing and mingling. He's talking about Israel, the true Hebrew Israelite. Now let's look at Isaiah 43. Isaiah 43. Now let's look at that. Isaiah 43. Let's look at verse 1, 2, 3. Let's look at that. It says, "But now thus saith the Lord, that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine." See that? "When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior." gave Egypt for a ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee. Now God here still is talking about who? Israel. He said, I'm your Savior. Not anyone else. No, let's go to Israel. Ezra. Let's go to the book of Ezra. Ezra here. Let's go to Ezra. Okay, let's go to Ezra 9. Now watch this, my brother and sister. Ezra 9. Let's look at Ezra 9. Let's look at verses 1 and 2. It says, now when these things were done, the princes came to me, saying, the princes came to Ezra, saying, the people of Israel and the prince and the Levites have not separated themselves from the people, of the land, doing according to their abominable, even the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Amorites, and the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Amorites. For they have taken of their daughters for themselves and for their sons, so that the holy seed have mingled themselves with the people of those lands. Yea, the head of the prince and rulers have been chief in this trespass. Now here Ed was saying that he have gotten word that the priests and the princes and all of man Israel done took the strangers for wives and different things, and they have trespassed. And Ezra say, oh no, that can't be true. They done that. And then if you go in and read it, it talks about Ezra grabbing the beard, pulling his beard out, and pulling the hair out of his head. You know, because they have done this great trespass. And see, one doesn't see the seriousness of you mingling the seed. Because if you go outside and mingle your seed, you have just committed suicide. You have just cut your generation off. You got to stay with those that are like you in order to produce you again. Because if you go outside, you can't produce what you are. You produce something else, but you can't reproduce your own self, the original. And you can't see it because Western civilization have fucked your head up. And then they have put this in front of you, you know, this leprous face with blonde hair and got a fan blowing that shit in the wind, and then keep on pounding in your head and pounding in your head that this is beautiful and this is what you should want. And then you, as a little child, that's all you see on television. And you grow up and you think that that's the way things are, and that couldn't be further from the truth. And just like these women now, you know, that looking like Beyonce and the rest of them, got these old hazel eyes and green eyes and all that shit tells you right off the bat that's mingleization. That is mingle. I mean, you should be able to recognize that right off the bat. And you should know that that's strange. I mean, you know that's not the way that an individual is supposed to look. You know it. If you go back 40 years ago or 50 years ago, you didn't see much of that shit. But now, this day in life, that's all you see. Every time you look. I mean, honestly, I can leave out my house, and in the run of a day, I may see one person that looks like me. One that resembles me. And the rest of them, I don't know what they are. But like I said in other videos, color is not all. It's the DNA. But color has a great part to do with it. Because, see, you can have mingleization in you and still be as black as I am. Yes. I have heard of individuals that are as dark as I am. They didn't have tests done, and then found out that they fucked up. And I'm telling you the truth. They have found out now that they fucked up, so you know they don't know which way to turn. Because they went in and had that test done, ancestry something, you know, and came back and they got all that shit in them. I mean, they got all kind of other nations and shit in them, and they as dark as I am. But see, but it goes, I keep on saying, it has to do with your DNA. If you're not original, then you're mixed up, you are mingled. Straight up and down. But those that look more or less like the white man, that's a straight out giveaway. Right off the bat. But the ones that look like me, they have a DNA test done, you know, they say, well, you know, I'm approved because I know that I'm Hebrew, and then they get tested back, and they're heartbroken. Because they find out they got all that shit in them. But like I say, that's nobody but the Most High. He says, I'm going to bring you to a naught. A remnant is a minute group of people. I don't care whether you black or whether you blue. I don't care. If you don't have the right DNA, you ain't none of his. And the right DNA is the Hebrew DNA. You can be angry. I mean, that's up to you. But that's not going to change, you know, what has transpired. And like, you know, they look at, you know, the Caucasian, you know, and I tell you, they get wet, they stinks, they do. And the mingle, they do the same. When they get wet, the ones that look like them, they stink. I mean, they stink. You need a gas mask on when they're around you. When I was in school, they would take a shower. Man, they would be stink, man. You need a gas mask. See, Israel, you need a gas mask like this. Because they smell like fish. They stink. It's like a fish when he's out of water. Like I said, they smell like a fish that's out of water. They stink. And the mingles smell the same way. When they get wet, I know I dated one that was almost white and didn't realize. But that was part of my journey to where I am now. But I thank the Most High that I did not create any beast or any creature that is walking around on this planet here. But God had his children to walk around for 40 years. And they didn't smell. Their feet didn't swell. They didn't want for nothing. Their clothes stayed intact. Their sandals stayed intact. That's how God took care of his children. But once they disobeyed God, God put a stench on them. And that's why we stink today when we don't take a bath. But they walked around for 40 years. And it doesn't talk about them taking no bath. Talk about them drinking water from a rock. But I didn't see anything about them taking no showers or jumping in no water. Because they was in a desert. Huh? But anyway, let's go a little further here. Let's look at the book of Daniel. Look at Daniel real quick here. And we're gonna see what Daniel had to say here. Let's look at Daniel 2. Now watch this, my brother and sister. Everything you need is right in the pages. Daniel 2, let's look at verse 43. It says, well, let's read 42 and 43. It says, and the toes of the feet were part iron and part clay, so that the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with the marred clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. And see, my sister and brother, I see all the time kids that, whatever they are, they have been mingled up with all this different nations and stuff in them. They have ADD and EFI and all this stuff. I call it retardation, you know, but they have these modern names for it. But these kids be sick all the time, and then they be all messed up. because that comes from mangalization. And one guy I was telling that, he got angry about it, but after he revisited, you know, and thought about it, he came back and said, "Hey, LD, man, I believe you're kind of right." Now, this was a white guy. Because, see, you shouldn't be mingling the seed. You shouldn't be. Now, let's go a little further here. Let's go to Malachi. See, because they need to know that there's a day that is going to come when you were so happy to have, I'm almost white, and this and that. But see, but there's a day that you got to pay for that. Because that's a curse on you. You don't really know it, but that's a curse on you, because God is going to send something that is going to mess you up. And like they say all the time on television, well, African Americans need to put sunscreen on too. Where? Up under my foot? I don't need it up under my foot because I'm walking on those. I don't need sunscreen anyplace else. But see, they're not talking about me. No, they're not. They're talking about the mix and the mingle. Well, that's what they're talking about. They need sunscreen. I don't. But look what the Most High says in Malachi 4 and 1. It says, "For behold, a day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear the name of the fear the name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings. And ye shall go forth and grow up as calves of the stall, and ye shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the sole of your feet in the day that the Lord shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. Remember ye the law of Moses," huh? And I'm going to show y'all about what Moses said. I'm going to bring some back to your attention. "Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded him and Hirah for all of Israel, with the statutes and judgment. Behold, I send you Elijah the prophet, huh? Before the coming of the dreadful day of the Lord, huh? And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." See that? Now, the Most High is saying that Elijah got to come back and get and bring structure. See, because if Elijah don't come back, I'm going to smite the earth with the curse. But we know Elijah's coming back. But remember what Moses said. Moses said that we should not give our sons and our daughters to any of the strangers. Don't give your daughters to their sons, and then don't let your sons be with their daughters. He said, because I have separated you from all of them. See that? So that is part of the laws that Moses told Israel way back. That still applies to this day. Now, look what he says here in Exodus. Let's go to Exodus 29. Let's go to Exodus 29. Now, watch it, my brother and sister. Exodus 29. Now, watch this. Exodus 29:45. Now watch this, my brothers and sisters. Exodus 29, 45, 45 and 46. Look what it says. He says, let's read 44. He said, "I will sanctify the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar. I will sanctify also both Aaron and his sons to minister to me in the priest's office." He says, and I will dwell among the children of Israel, and will be their God. And they shall know that I am the Lord their God, that brought them out of the land of Egypt, that I may dwell among them. I am the Lord their God. You see, this is what the Most High wanted way back there. He wanted to be with his people. The Most High wanted to dwell among his people, and he's going to do it. When he comes back, after Elijah comes back and get everything in order for him to show up, he's going to show up, and he's going to take us and put us in our land. And he said he's going to put his word inside of us. He's going to put his spirit inside of us. And we will do all of his judgments and his commandments. And the Most High says, I'm going to dwell among my people. And I'm going to be their God, and they're going to be my people. This was pronounced years ago with our ancestors. But it's going to be fulfilled with us. Now look what he says in Isaiah 44. Let's look at Isaiah 44 here real quick. Let's look at that scripture. Isaiah 44. Isaiah 44. Let's get that one. All right, it's 43. Isaiah 44. Isaiah 44. Let's look at verses 21. That's what I want. Isaiah 44:21. No, that's not the one I want. Let's go to Jeremiah. Let's go to Jeremiah 31. This is one of our favorite. Jeremiah 31:1. Look what it says. It says, at the same time, saith the Lord, will I be the God of all the families of Israel. Did y'all hear that? He did not say the world. He said, the families of Israel. Let's read again. He said, at the same time, saith the Lord, will I be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. My brothers and sisters, he didn't say the mix or the mingle. He didn't say the Gentiles. He didn't say the Caucasian. He said only Israel. And he's talking about the true Hebrew Israelites, the one that had not been tainted, the one that has the same blood, the bloodline that had not been mingled from Abraham up until now. And the Most High says, straight up and down, he says, there's not a whole lot of y'all. He says, I'm going to bring you to naught. So that means that ain't that many of us, huh? So my sisters and brothers, we here at LiveAminimo.org, we hope that this Sabbath teaching has been a blessing to you, and we praise the Most High forever and ever, and we thank him for all that he has done for all of us here at LiveAminimo.org, as well as all of our sisters and brothers that are out there in cyberspace and all over the world. We just thank you for allowing us to come in. Until our next Sabbath, Shalom, my brothers and sisters.